Hey everyone, and welcome to our Wednesday night service. We're doing it again online because of this pandemic. But go ahead and look in the description right now. You're going to see the verse that we're going over. It's Acts 8, 26 through 35. But right there, you're also going to see a thumbs up button. Go ahead and like it. Go ahead and leave a comment or send me a text. Just let me know that you're watching. Let me know what you thought about tonight's message. And just keep me updated. Let's keep some communication going. And then third and most important to me is go ahead and smash that subscribe button. Because if you do that, then you're going to be able to see when we upload something. Because it's not just going to be me. I also want this to be a platform of which we can communicate with y'all better. And just have more services, have more opportunities to promote and just get the word out. So go ahead and hit that subscribe button. All right, so today we're going to be continuing in our sermon series on service. Last week we looked at the life of Philip, or at least part one of it, because this week is part two of how to serve like Philip. So today we're going to be unpacking two ways of how Philip served, and those two ways is he served without hesitation, and he served with compassion. So that's what we're going to be looking at today, and we see that in Acts 8, 26 through 35. So go ahead and read along with me, either in your own scripture, in your own word, or in the description below. Now an angel of the Lord said to Philip, "Rise and go towards the south to the road that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza. This is a desert place." And he arose and he went. And there was an Ethiopian, a eunuch, a court official of Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, who was in charge of all of her treasure. And he came to Jerusalem to worship and was returning, seated in his chariot. And he was reading the prophet Isaiah. And the Spirit said to Philip, "Go over and join this chariot." So Philip ran to him and heard him reading from Isaiah the prophet and asked, "Do you understand what you are reading?" And he said, "How can I, unless someone guides me?" And he invited Philip to come up and sit with him. Now the passage of scripture that he was reading was this: "Like a sheep he was led to the slaughter, and like a lamb before his shearer is silent, so he opens not his mouth. In his humiliation, justice was denied him. Who can describe his generation? For his life is taken away from the earth." And the eunuch said to Philip, "About whom, I ask you, does this prophet say this about? About himself or about someone else?" Then Philip opens his mouth, and beginning with this scripture, he told him the good news about Jesus. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for examples of faithful servants. I pray for everyone that's listening to this sermon today. I pray that you open up their hearts, you open up their ears, and you just soften their hearts to hear from you, God. I pray that this word may penetrate their hearts, it may change their lives. And God, I just pray that you use me as a faithful servant, that it not be my words today, God, but it be yours, and that everything said will bring glory and honor to you. Amen. All right, so there's a few things that we need to understand before going into this passage today. And the three things that we really need to understand is, one, what's a eunuch? Two, why would someone become a eunuch? And three, what does society think about eunuchs? Or how do they treat them in this time? Well, first, what is a eunuch? And this is the most awkward part of this passage today, so we're going to get it out of the way. A eunuch is a male who has had his male parts either mutilated or castrated, removed, in order that he can no longer produce any children. Now, if you need any further explanation than that, you should probably ask your parents. Maybe they can do a better job, but that's not how I'm going to be doing it today. But now that we have a general understanding of what a eunuch is, why would someone have this done to them, or why would they do it to themselves? And what we see in the ancient world is that most people that were a eunuch did not do this themselves. They were a servant or they were a slave, and their masters would have them become a eunuch. And the reason they would have them become a eunuch is because a eunuch was far more trusted. So a king would have his advisors and he would make them become eunuchs. That way they wouldn't have a wife, they wouldn't have kids, they wouldn't have in-laws. So when they were advising him, that would be giving him earnest, true advice and not stuff that would just make them profit. The king no longer had to worry about his advisors whispering stuff into his ear so that they may become the king, that they might have their offspring become rulers. He no longer had to worry about that because they weren't able to do that. And a second way that they would have eunuchs serve is if they had any man working with the queen. That way, if she had guards or she has a treasurer, like in the story today, the king had that peace of mind knowing that none of them could impregnate his wife. Because the worst thing that could have happened for him is for him to unknowingly have an heir that was not his. For him to pass on the throne to a child that was not his son. So that's kind of the reason of why people would make their servants become eunuchs. And then third, we have to understand how the culture treated eunuchs, how they thought about them. What we know about the ancient civilizations is that we're very male-driven. They were very male-oriented. That if you were a male, then you were considered good. Like, males were the only ones that could vote. They were the only ones that could hold property, with some exceptions. But on average, it was a male's world. So a male that was no longer a male that no longer had his manhood, that could no longer produce children, that could no longer make sons, was considered to be less than. He was subhuman. He was no longer good for being what he was supposed to be good for. See, eunuchs were the lowest class. But the strange thing about them was that while they were the lowest class, they were seated among the highest because of their servanthood. So even though they were low class, they were right next to the highest positions. So now we have a little bit of context of what a eunuch is, why they would become one, and how society kind of treated them. What does this mean for how Philip served? Well, the first thing we see today is that Philip served without hesitation. First, we see it in verse 26, where it says, "Now an angel of the Lord said to Philip, 'Rise and go towards the south, to the road that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza. This is a desert place.' And he rose and went." See, what we see is that he's prompted by an angel of the Lord to go. And we see that he goes. He's not prompted of why he's going. He's not prompted of what's going to happen. He's just told, hey, this is the direction you need to go. This is the road you need to be on. Go. And we see, like a faithful servant, he gets up and he goes. The second period that we see today is in verse 29. It says, "And the Spirit said to Philip, 'Go over and join this chariot.' So Philip ran to him, heard him reading Isaiah the prophet." So what we see here is the reason why Philip was told to go. Philip was told to go to get on this road so that he would come to this chariot, so that he would have this opportunity to share the word of the Lord with this Ethiopian eunuch. So we've seen that he's listening to the Spirit. He sees this chariot. He's told, go to that chariot. And we see that he runs to it. Now, that may not seem like something important to us, but what we really need to understand about the context of that culture is that if a man is running, that is disgraceful. A man did not run because that did not show that he was proper, that he was distinguished, that he was respectable. But we see that Philip, being the servant that he is, said, "You want me there? I'm going there as fast as I can." You see, what we see from this is that Philip was willing. That he understood that following God was worth it, and that it was something that he wanted to do. Oftentimes, the only time we really see when somebody does something without hesitation is when they really want to do it. It makes me think of the illustration of the young boy that never does anything. He's a couch potato. He you never see him running. You never see him doing any sort of exercise or anything like that. And then all of a sudden, you hear this kind of music. You hear it coming across the street, and you hear it getting louder and louder and louder. And it's that familiar sound of an ice cream truck. And then all of a sudden, this kid that you've never seen run before is running as fast as he can just to get there so he can get his favorite ice cream cone. And I know this illustration kind of sounds just kind of funny. And it's something that we can all picture in our heads. And I know it's something that I did when I was younger. But honestly, I really do think that this encapsulates this idea that if we want something, that's when we're going to be completely sold out to it. If we truly want something, that's when we're going to give up everything and go and do it without hesitation. We see this today with Philip. We see that he's completely sold out for what the Spirit wants for him to do. He's completely sold out for what Jesus has called for him. And we see that even without a destination, without a goal, an end goal, he says, yes, I will go. And that's what we need to be as well. We need to be so willing, so in love with who God is, that wherever he goes, or he says to go, we go. No questions asked, no hesitation. We go. So we see that Philip served without hesitation, but we also see that he served compassionately. Just earlier, we talked about how the society treated or how they thought about eunuchs. And a lot of that is brought about because of Deuteronomy 23. In Deuteronomy 23, just the first verse, if you want to read it, go ahead and read it. It basically what it lays out is that eunuchs were not allowed to be part of the assembly of God in the temple. That they weren't allowed to participate in any of those ceremonies or anything that happened in the temple because they were not complete. They were not good enough. They were not acceptable in that area. And while we can understand that scripture and understand what it's supposed to mean, the cultural stigma of what that did is show that if you are a eunuch, then you are subpar, that you are subhuman, that you are not good enough. And that sticks around, and we see it not only in the Jewish culture, but we also see it in the cultures around as well, because in that culture, if you were a male and you were no longer a male, then you weren't good. You weren't good enough. And what we see is that Philip is told to go to that chariot. He realizes that this eunuch is reading out Isaiah. And he goes to him, and he preaches the word to him. But what I really want to talk to you guys about real quick is the amazing word of which this eunuch was reading. He was stuck in chapter 53 of Isaiah. Now, obviously, back then, they didn't have the chapters and the breaks that we have. But chronologically speaking, he was in chapter 53. And that's where he was stuck. He was stuck on the foreshadowing of Christ being that sacrifice. But if we look three chapters ahead in chapter 56, we see that Isaiah talks about eunuchs. He talks about this man, essentially. Not specifically, but essentially. And what he talks about is that if a eunuch keeps the Sabbath, if a eunuch keeps the ways of God, if he obeys the law, then he too can be in eternity. So much like in Isaiah 53, Isaiah 56 is also a foreshadowing towards Jesus, meaning that no matter who you are, no matter what you've done in the past, no matter what's happened to you, if you follow Jesus, you can be saved. You will be saved. And that's a promise in Scripture. So we see that Philip, knowing this, knowing the Scriptures, he goes and he preaches the Word of God to this eunuch. He starts with the verses that he's stuck on. He starts in Isaiah 53 and he pulls it forward to what the gospel of Christ is. And he shows him that he is someone that Christ died for. He shows him that he is worth Christ's death, while society is telling him that he is worthless. Philip took compassion on this person that society calls trash. He took compassion on this person that society did not care about at all. And he shared with him the greatest news ever. He shared with someone that they were worth that sacrifice. See, what we see from Philip doing this is that he truly understood the depravity of what hell is. He understood the depravity of what it means to live without Christ. But he also understood the full context, the full truth of the gospel. Because when you know that, when you know the full truth of what the gospel is, you have nothing else that you want to share. There's nothing else that's important enough for you to run to someone to go share. And we see that Philip did that without hesitation, and he did it with compassion because he knows that everyone needs salvation in Christ. So what do we need to understand about how Philip served? Obviously, this is a part two of a two-part series. And last week, we saw that he served boldly, that he served willingly. And we see the same thing with the week before with Stephen. We see that all of these men of God are serving willingly. Well, if we're wanting to serve like him, then we have to have that same passion for the gospel of Christ that he had. That we must serve without hesitation, just like him. And we must serve with the same love for others as he had, so we may serve just as compassionately. So maybe we need to ask ourselves, do I love God enough to serve in that way? Do I love God enough for me to serve without hesitation? And if that's a yes, then that is a great encouragement, and I'm glad you could listen to this message today. If it's a no, then that's something that you need to get checked, because if you don't love God enough to serve without hesitation, then your relationship with him needs to get better. And then the second question you need to ask yourself is, do I love people enough for me to serve with the same compassion that Philip served with? And it's a little bit harder because it's not like we have eunuchs today, but there are people that we view in the same light as society treated eunuchs. So ask yourself, who do we view that way? And then you need to ask yourself is, do I treat them with that same compassion that we see Philip treating them? You need to ask yourself, do I love people as much as Philip did? Do I love people as much as God loved me? Now, obviously, that's unattainable, but striving towards it, are you even striving towards it? So this is a message of either encouragement or reflection. So after this, go ahead, take some time to pray. Take some time to realize where you are in your salvation, where you are in your walk with God. If you need to grow, or if you just needed a pat on the back for doing what is right. I pray that this is a message that you were able to get something out of and was able to touch your heart. But let's go ahead and pray. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for the encouragement. Thank you for the conviction. I pray that we're all able to get something out of this, that we're all able to apply it to our lives, to change our lives in betterment for you, God. I pray that we're all able to get opportunities to serve you. And in those opportunities, that we take it courageously, that we take it without hesitation, and in those opportunities that we serve you, God, we serve people compassionately. I pray for everybody hearing this message today that does not know you. I pray that you put that burden on their lives that they may want to seek your face, God. And I pray for those that do know you. I pray that you draw them even closer, that they become more and more like you as the days go on, God. And I pray all this in your glorious and holy name. Amen. Well, thank you guys for listening. And as I said at the beginning, go ahead and like, comment, and subscribe. We'd love to get those numbers up. And feel free to share this. Let your friends know. Just enjoy this message with them as well. All right. Thank you guys for listening. Have a good day.